In the last episode, we compared different methods of controlling an Arduino over Wi-Fi. And from those methods, HTTP is the one that gives you the most freedom. However, it comes at a cost, because you have to create your own graphical user interface in the form of a mobile or web application. If you missed this episode, I'll leave its link in the description below. So, what is HTTP? HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol, and it is the backbone of the internet. To better understand HTTP, we'll take as example watching a video on YouTube. First, HTTP follows the standard client and server model. And in the case of our example, YouTube is the server that contains all the videos, and you are the client that wishes to access those videos. Also, you should know that HTTP is an application layer and not a transmission layer. Usually, the transmission layers follows the TCP protocol. And this means that HTTP is not responsible of transmitting your message. Instead, it acts as a template to the message you want to send. This template should include a method, which is the type of request that you are sending. The most common methods are GET, POST, and DELETE. The GET method fetches data from the server. For example, if you want to watch a video on YouTube, the GET method will tell YouTube to send you the video. The POST method, on the other hand, sends data to the server. For example, if you want to upload a video to YouTube or post a comment on this video to tell me how well I'm explaining HTTP so far, which by the way I strongly recommend, you will use the POST method. Finally, the DELETE method does just as it says, it deletes data from the server. In addition to the method, an HTTP message includes a header, which contains very important information, such as the address of the server, which is usually an IP address or a URL. Also, you can send any additional data in the body of the HTTP message, such as a video file or your comment in a text format. Now you should know the basics of HTTP. So let's start by implementing our first HTTP project, where we are going to turn a LED on or off and read the temperature and humidity from a DHT11 sensor. This to demonstrate how to send and receive data from an Arduino and allow you to create virtually any project you want. For this project, we will configure an ESP8266, also known as a Node MCU, to be the server that you will access from any device connected to the same network. To send requests to the Arduino, we simply need to enter its IP address followed by your custom command in any browser, and reply with a custom HTML message that would contain the status of the LED as well as the temperature and humidity readings. You can find the IP address of the Arduino in the serial monitor after running your code. Before diving into the code, let's see how to wire everything up. First, I will connect the output of the DHT11 to pin D4, also referred to as GPIO2, and the LED to pin D6, also referred to as GPIO12. Note that there is no need for a resistor to be connected in series with the LED, since the digital output of the Node MCU is only 3.3 volts. Now, let's dive into the Arduino code, and by the way, you can download it using the link in the description below. First, you need to include the needed libraries to communicate over Wi-Fi and read the DHT11 sensor. Then, you need to enter your Wi-Fi credentials. The SSID is the name of your Wi-Fi, as you see it on your phone or laptop. And the password, well, it's that thing that you need to hide the most from your neighbors. Then, we need to configure our Arduino to be a server. After that, in the void setup, we will initialize the DHT sensor and connect the Arduino to the Wi-Fi network. In the void loop, we will start by reading the temperature and humidity from the DHT11 sensor and store them in temporary variables. You might have noticed that there are some if-else statements. These are just used to spot any error in the reading. In case of an error, the temperature and humidity will be set to zero. After reading from the DHT11, we will check if any client wishes to connect with us, the server. If yes, we will listen to their message and store it in a string. Then we will check if this string contains any one of our custom control messages. Here you can create new commands to control most of. After that, we will execute the commands received, in this case turning the LED on or off. And finally, we will send a reply to the client in the form of a string containing an HTML message that includes the status of the LED, the temperature, and the humidity readings. If you wish to send back more information, this is the section you should modify. You should now be able to control your LED from your browser and receive the readings of the DHT11 sensor. As you can see, I did not dive deep in the user interface, but if you are planning on using the HTTP method, you should probably consider creating a mobile or web application with buttons that would send your custom URLs instead of directly typing them in your browser. Also, if there's any part you did not really understand, or if you are facing any problem, share it with me in the comment section below. You might be helping out someone with the same problem. Next week, we'll cover the second method of controlling an Arduino over Wi-Fi by using the Blink app, which instead of setting the Arduino to be the server, has its dedicated server on the internet, which allows us to control the Arduino remotely. So if you don't want to miss this episode, make sure to subscribe. And in the meantime, you should probably watch one of the videos on the screen right now. And like the video if you found it useful. And I will see you next week.